Dr. David Kimbro and Dr. Randall Hughes work to unlock the secrets of the intertidal zone, where the land meets the sea.
It's really tricky getting a lot of people coming from a lot of different perspectives, particularly when there's history of challenging communications, but this is actually a time when people are coming together and putting resources together, and that's what needs to get marshaled.
My team, pretty much my graduate student, Hannah Garland, you can raise your hand, Hannah. She's been on the Bay considerably since January. We've also begun to implement a predation experiment, and so I think my team has met with a lot of the people smart to kind of tell you what all these ugly floats are.
This just says FSU research, and then it'll have our activities license on it and a number they can call us.
Why we're putting them out, these big cages out under oysteries, and that's to look at the effects of predators.
For our adult oyster experiment in Apalachicola Bay, we needed Shawn, our oysterman, to collect 500 adult oysters.
That's about 2 bushels, maybe a little over 2 bushels.
So how do you know what spot you want to try out?
You just know what the bar is, and then you just go and try it. If there ain't nothing there, you find somewhere else to go. Worth of work.
How much did you use to get?
In 30 minutes, you used to get about a bag and a half, which is somewhere around 350, close to 400 inches. Two of them bugs is a bag. Yeah, before you get 500 oysters, it probably took me about 45 minutes total.
How many bags are you bringing back?
We were getting about 23, 26.
Well, like I said, I should be able to get 500 today, hopefully. I didn't think it was going to be quite this bad still. I was thinking about 4 hours I should have had them, but it ain't going to work out that way. This is 1/4 of the way.
125 right here. I'm done. How about that? I got you. All pretty cup oysters, that's about all I can tell you.
No, unfortunately it wasn't surprising. I mean, based on our surveys when Stephanie and I were swimming the transects, I mean, we were rarely seeing healthy big clumps, and even right here, this is a gaper that I see right here, so we can't even use this oyster. But no, I mean, it certainly wasn't surprising that he only got 100 or so oysters after 4 hours of tonguing. It's the reality of what's out there.
Well, we know the shell part of it. We know the shell part of work.
You get a lot of shell out there. A lot. Ten times more than it's been done this year, and do it for five consecutive years. So this model and others that we run show that you can recover the population considerably faster.
As far as the research goes, I don't know, because we've had the state doing it for 20 plus years, and they really haven't made that much of a difference one way or the other. And you know, we've done it all our lives, and then they try to convince us that, you know, this is what the problem is when we all know better. So as far as scientists and all that stuff, oystermen themselves don't have a whole lot of faith in them.
There was some concern about outsiders coming into this community and potentially having more influence than insiders might appreciate.
Well, the thing is, they're going through the right way about it. They're asking us first. You know, they're wanting to get educated from us as well as we're trying to get educated from them.
It's critical that we have feedback from the community to help us guide, you know, to fine-tune things so that the study can be as good as it can be. We design a pretty sort of survey and experimental scheme of this whole system, and we heard from the local oystermen that they're just mystified. They didn't incorporate the big reefs that they have depended on for the past 50 years. We were able to adjust our sampling design and experimental design to incorporate the local knowledge that's accumulated for a century.
In the Grass on the Reef is funded by the National Science Foundation.